Dioll was a world of giant rock pillar formations which reached out of a misty valley deep below. Flat mesas at the top formed badlands on which the humans and their servants lived. Most of the communities were small towns, scientific outposts, or military bases. One city, Corwell, took up most of the mesa on which it sat. The natives resided in the valleys, but they were hidden from view below the mist. Few outsiders knew much about this mysterious species. As the freebird approached, Aelor felt something from these foggy valleys. It was a presence, but one she could not understand because it was spread evenly throughout. She looked to Master Dintra for guidance.
"Did you feel that?"
she asked.
"Yes, we're going into re-entry,"
he said.
"I mean the pull of the force from the misty parts of the planet. I can't feel anything further down, though. Can you?"
"Oh, you mean that. I felt that a while ago. Yes, the force is certainly strong with this planet. Let's keep our minds open to it."
Roach passed by at that moment on his way to the front to pilot the men for a landing. He stopped and said,
"I felt it."
And he held out a thumb as he walked away. The two ships lowered into their assigned landing platforms. As they did, they could see what Debly and Aelor had warned them about regarding this sector. Non-humans were almost always slaves. And when they weren't slaves, they were off-worlders doing a job here as quickly as possible so they could leave. Staring at this with anger, Yalto came up with a plan.
"All right, our one clue as to where Ms. Creslat is at the Kassido Center of Natural Selection, so that's where we're going. They'll likely only respond to humans, so Aelor, Roach, and Master Dentro will be the ones to talk with them. I'll go as your servant. Roach, stop juggling grenades."
"Aw, I didn't pull the pins."
"Dentra, you'll be Briley's uncle. Roach is your son, and Aelor is your sister. You've had a family emergency, and you've come to tell Briely and bring her back with you. Doubly, you keep an eye on our six."
"If it's all the same to you, Lieutenant, Reggie and I would like to take a look around this place. See what we can dig up."
"Okay, well, I'm a little nervous. You might get scooped up as a slave. They seem to do that with non-humans here."
"Don't you worry, your green horned head. No one is gonna take me in and walk away alive."
And so the two teams separated. Doubly and R3G1 wandered the streets of the town, and the others headed out to the Center of Natural Selection, an office dedicated to proving humans superior to other races. The lobby was a large open area with two-story windows in the front and the back, and hallways to offices on both sides. The reception desk stood in the middle. Master Dentra approached it. His robe was a beautiful flowing purple, the color of the interior of his Jedi robes, which he had now turned inside out to fit in with the look of the elite in this area. Taking on an air of sophisticated snobbery, Dentra declared,
"Greetings, Secretary. We are the Creslat family. We've come to find our daughter on a matter of great urgency. I must speak with one of your attendants who can inform us of her current whereabouts."
"Very good, sir. And your first name?"
Dentra sighed as if annoyed that his time was being wasted.
"Doubly. Doubly Creslat. And please make it snappy. We need to find her ASAP."
"Right away, sir."
Dentra rejoined the others at a nearby bench. There, Roach was getting really into his role of being Yalto's master, ordering him to switch places with him on the bench, then back again, wanting something out of the luggage he was carrying for them, etc. Yalto whispered to him to stop getting so deeply into the part. The wait wasn't long, and soon an official called them into his office. The man offered them candies, and Dentra said no thanks. But Roach leaped at the table and began filling his mouth with them. "What house do you hail from?" the man asked. Aelor froze. She hadn't thought to tell them much about the local houses. But Dentra didn't miss a beat. He said,
"It's a very small house, made up primarily just of our family. House Creslat. I'm sure you haven't heard of us. We stay to smaller worlds just outside the sector. But about my niece, Briely Creslat. She works in one of your research centers. I don't know which one. She has been a loyal employee and has never provided privileged information outside of work. But now we must get hold of her, for there has been a family emergency."
"Well, you've been in touch with her, right?" the man asked, confused. "I mean, why not just contact her in the way you usually do?" Roach was standing wide-eyed at the desk, popping candies, and he turned around and said,
"Yeah, why didn't we?"
Yalto
snapped, about to chastise Roach, but he stopped himself, remembering his place as a slave in this scenario.
"Roland?" end, now your father is speaking. Okay, let him answer.
Roach turned back around to the office manager and winked with a grin.
That's my slave.
He heard Yalto quietly growl.
Because of her sensitive work, we only speak with Briely once every now and then. We don't even have her contact information. She has to call us. And this is such an emergency. We don't have time to wait.
I understand, the man said. Nothing comes before family. He typed away with a friendly grin plastered across his face and ended with a final tap. There she is, he said, and he told them which research station she was at, and how to get to it. They would need to take a skyhopper to get there as it was on one of the other mesas.
Thank you for your help,
Dentra said, and he encouraged everyone out the door. But Roach stayed put, staring at the man with his wide eyes and said,
Hey, mister, I have a question.
One could almost hear his three companions groan. The man behind the desk looked at the boy curiously. Roach said,
Is there a limit on the number of candies I can take?
The man shook his head and shrugged, so Roach grabbed a handful of them and said,
Thanks!
And ran out the door. Dudley, meanwhile, had spent the time seeing if he could find someone who was non-human, yet free. That's why he was excited to meet a native Diolan at an open-air market. Dudley asked why he was there, and the man explained that Diolans occasionally came up to the mesas to share in the different foods to see what off-worlders had brought. This part intrigued Dudley as he assumed Diolans would have access to beings from other planets, but the man told him that outsiders never try landing in the valleys where the Diolans live. That led to Dudley asking about where the Diolans live, and the man told him that they live deeply within the mist. That was when they introduced themselves. The Dioland was Maj Quelon.
Nice to make your acquaintance. May I offer you a ride home?
Flying into the mist can be a daunting task, even with my help.
Lucky for me, I also have very skilled astromech.
Very well, I would be honored, Marge said, and Dudley showed him to his Y-Wing as they continued their conversation.
Dudley told him about other areas of the galaxy, and Marge told him about his home. Marge directed Dudley to some of the more scenic areas, out past the city to the gaps between the cliffs. Between the giant rock pillars, they skimmed across the fog, their wake flying up the vapor behind like a parting wave. Maj was thrilled. He had only ever flown in a local skyhopper which left very little turbulence behind it. Dudley was fascinated. He spotted the occasional leathery flying creature that rose up out of the clouds to spy on them before dropping out of sight again beneath the gray waves. Among the cliffs themselves were occasional holes and cavities inside of which Dudley occasionally felt eyes watching out at them. There were also the occasional buildings stuck to the cliffs like shelves clung to the walls. At last, Maj showed him how to get to his home. They slowly sank into the gray ocean until they were enveloped by the mist. It seemed to swirl around his ship unnaturally, as though its waves of vapor were conscious in its twists and turns. From behind him, Maj told Dudley where and when to turn. Dudley had to trust him, seeing nothing and with his instruments not reliably telling him where to go. Reggie squawked warnings, but they were when the turns were too late, more of a confirmation of Maj's instructions.
There is something odd about this fog.
The mist is symbolic with all living things within its valley. It surrounds its people, penetrates our souls, and binds everyone and everything within its embrace.
That sounds like another living energy I have heard of. A living force, binding all things.
There is a mist where you live? Maj asked.
No. Something much bigger and greater than any one world.
Deep within the oceanic fog of the Dioll Valley, signs of civilization began to emerge out of the stone outcroppings. Doorways and balconies hugged the mammoth pillars, and bridges led to platforms atop giant stalagmites, which were carved into the shapes of lived-in towers. Winged people glided from building to entrance wall, as though swimming through the gray murk. Dudley and Maj landed on a small, flattened stone landing pad, the only spacefaring vessel on it. There were only a handful of local skyhoppers the Diolans occasionally used. Seeing them made Dudley realize that Maj had probably left his in the city. That's okay, Maj said. I will go with someone else another time to show it. You seem like someone who should see this.
How do you know I am the right person to show this to? And not some marauder that is here to sack the town.
The mist guides me, Maj said without fear. Others around them lacked any suspicion as well, though they acknowledged him as he passed. They seemed to Dudley the most serene people he had ever witnessed.
Reggie caught up with them and they followed their guide as he led them through the village. Though the mist had gotten heavier as they had lowered, it lightened for about the last 50 feet at the bottom. At least by sight. Dudley could still feel the presence of the moisture as though under a very light liquid. He noticed that those who were gliding seemed to swim as much as fly. Objects that were thrown hovered longer than they should have in this gravity, and seemed to even change course slightly to land in other Dioll's hands. Dudley wasn't sure, but it seemed as though someone had even reached for an object that had jumped a couple inches into their hand. All around him in the meantime were the echoes and the slow, wallowing modulations that sounded like a whale song. He wondered at first if it was the sounds of some great beast wandering among the pillars, but then he spotted Dioll's throwing their voices into the air, up at the cliff walls. He saw others at holes in these same cliffs calling out with other sounds. They were not words they were saying, not even in Dioll. But, he mused, they were sounds of a type of slow, droning yodel, which bounced from cliff to cliff, traveling from caller to listener. Looking closely, Dudley could even see some of the ripples in the fog, like wake in the water behind a boat. Maj smiled at the wonder in Dudley's face. "You too behold the wonder of the mist?" he asked.
"I do,"
Dudley answered. "Would you like to see more, my friend?"
"Yes."
Reggie squawked and beeped. It was less impressed and more concerned with carrying on with their mission.
"It's okay, Reggie. You stay here. Watch over the ship. Remind me when it gets close to sunset."
Reggie watched nervously as Dudley strode away with the Dioll, disappearing into the curtain of gray. Most of the others had found where they wanted to go and had decided to head to it the next morning. For now, they were celebrating in a hotel bar right off of the spaceport. They had sent a message to Dudley as to where he could find them, but he hadn't responded. Roach suggested that he might have gone somewhere that the signal was bad, so they decided not to worry and waited for him to arrive. In the meantime, Dentra struck up a conversation with the Sullison pilot who flew goods out to research stations across the planet. Dentra asked him about the station they would be going to the next day, and the Sullison looked up at him suspiciously. Dentra may be charming, but he was a human on a world that often enslaved outer-worlders, so the Sullison threw questions back at Dentra, asking more about House Krizlat. That was when Yalto stepped in and made a point of talking at Dentra's level. The Sullison got the picture, that these were not Kassido goons, and he opened up again. He described the research centers as dugout areas of the giant natural pillars. They typically had an entrance at the top that lowered people into the work area by elevator, and a steel and glass structure sticking out of the side that looked out at the mist, and mines that dug into the ground. They were particularly fascinated with the fog that covered all the valleys. Kassido scientists were taking samples of it and trying to see if it was a type of gas they could use in weaponry, or if it would have some other use.
"So they do all this at the research station?"
Yalto asked. "Nope. They hire pilots like me to fly the sample to the science center where they study it."
"Science center?"
The Sullison showed them on a map which mesa held the science center.
"What all they do there, I do not know. But I know they're sending a lot of things from research centers to the science center, and sometimes back again."
Dentra made a segue to other conversations so the pilot didn't feel used. Asking about his home, the Sullison said that he wasn't comfortable going there right now.
"Solus is being surrounded by some kind of fleet. It's not Imperial. I don't know what's going on, but it probably isn't good."
Aelor was in the Freebird practicing her moves, honing her skills, remembering her training. She wanted to be ready when the time came that she would face the Dark Lord again. And yet, there was something to this planet that drew her to it like gravity. She couldn't put her finger on it, but it lingered like a dim light she just couldn't see. Then it suddenly felt stronger. She left the ship and walked toward it. The sun was low on the horizon as she found herself heading to the hotel bar the others were in. Roach sat curled up in a chair in the hotel lobby watching a holoscreen program. He was bored, but not ready to sleep, and he had gotten kicked out of the bar for being too young. Then his attention was pulled to someone who had just entered.
"Pilotman Dudley,"
Roach exclaimed. Then he stopped.
"That is you, right?"
Dudley bore a stature of serenity over his whole body so complete that he looked like a new Duros.
"Yes, Termite. It has never been more than now."
"Oh, okay. Hey, Eleanor."
Aelor had followed Dudley inside. She looked at him oddly.
He did not react, but instead just strolled into the bar and joined the others.
Captain Vance, we're starting to get worried about you,
Yalto said.
No need to worry for me, Lieutenant. I have never felt better.
You look relaxed,
Dentra said.
I feel a great spirit.
Ah, he's been to the mist, the Sullison said. Some people go in, think they've had some kind of awakening, and they never come back.
Have you been to the valley?
I've skimmed the top, but never dared fly further into it, the Sullison said.
It is a place of great beauty and serenity. A place of great wonder. Some of the natives have even learned to control the mist around them.
That sounds like the Force,
Dentra said.
Much like it. Like a concentrated form of it,
Doubly explained. Later that night, the five team members sat up in one of the rooms talking about their plans for the next day. Obviously, they wanted to get Briely as soon as possible. However, they had grown curious about what was being done on this planet, and once they got Briely, they were going to have to escape the planet. So they decided to do everything else they wanted to do on the planet before going to her research station. First, they would go to the small town near the science center. There, they would learn how best to infiltrate the structure. Once they knew how, they would raid the facility and hopefully get out unannounced with the data. They would probably be limited on time before something seemed awry. So they would go to the research center Briely was at as soon as possible and get her out. Dentra, however, wanted to see this valley that Doubly was raving about. So he asked that they return to the monastery where Doubly had gone, and the two of them would join the others at the research center.
I don't mind. In fact, it'll make the cover easier with fewer people. But remember that comms don't work very well down in the mist, so you're going to have to keep a very close eye on time.
Dentra and Doubly promised they would, and the plan was made as complete as possible before they headed to bed for the night. The following morning, Doubly and Dentra flew off toward the sun rising over the rippling mist. The rest of them, including R3G1, rented a couple of skyhoppers and flew over to the small town. As they came close, they could see the science center nearby, and that the entire compound was surrounded by a wall with guard posts. There were a few buildings near the edge, and one large building in the center which they determined to get to. The main issue would be how, and what they would need to get inside. They landed at the relatively small skyport and went about wandering the town, leaving Reggie behind to watch the skyhoppers. They retained their covers from the day before, with Aelor escorting her nephew, while their slave carried their belongings. Those bags now contained parts of their weapons, which they could assemble when needed.
You don't have to make such a big deal about the slave part, though, kid,
Yalto told Roach.
I know. This time, we're gonna be brothers.
I don't think you understand how genetics work.
Just stay to the plan,
Aelor snapped.
This town is probably set up to house the people who work at the Science Center. So we need to find out what they do to get in and out and do what they're doing.
Yes, ma'am, Eleanor,
Roach said. As they wandered down the main street, they noticed fewer people who owned slaves, though they looked on Yalto with a level of condescension or spite, or both. None of the storefronts were fancy. Everything had a quaint, homely feel to it. The locals were friendly to the humans, and there were no off-worlders. None that were free, anyway. A fair number of the humans wore uniforms that looked like they were from the Science Center. Some still had their name tags on their chests, which bore barcodes. They went into one of the diners for breakfast, slipping onto the stools at the bar. A waitress named Barb asked what they would have.
One alcohol, please,
Roach exclaimed. Purple cow milk it is, Barb answered. Ella ordered some breakfast for herself, and some for her slave. Then some for her nephew so he would have some sort of nutrition in him. Yalto noticed some of the patrons stealing side glances at him, and he overheard a couple make racist remarks. He pulled out his large knife and started cleaning under his fingernails. Aelor took a look at some of them and noticed that one of the booths had three people wearing scientific uniforms at it. She got an idea of their clothes sizes and thought they might be close to their own, or at least her and Roach. She turned to Barb and asked if those uniforms meant they worked at the nearby science center. They do, yeah. Most of the people in the town are somehow connected to that place, Barb said. After Barb left, Aelor leaned in to Yalto to talk about a plan.
I was thinking the same thing.
I was too,
Roach said.
What is it?
Yalto and Aelor nodded their heads at the booth. Roach leaned back in his stool and saw them. He caught one of them giving a dirty look at Yalto,
so Roach made a dirty face at her, then leaned forward again and said,
I'm in.
Yalta whispered a plan to them.
You lure them outside, Elor. The kid and I will be waiting and we'll knock them out.
Elor was about to agree, but Roach interrupted.
Let me do this one. I got an idea.
I appreciate it, kid, but...
Whoever is outside is going to have to do the beating.
Roach interrupted again.
You and Eleanor are a lot better at that.
Yalta fell silent. Elor shrugged. The kid had a point. Roach leaned back and winked at the woman who had been giving his friend a dirty look.
Okay, whatever you do, don't get caught by them before you get outside. We don't want to have to run back in here and rescue you.
No problem. Go. Go!
Yalta and Elor got up and walked out the back. Barb brought the purple cow's milk to Roach and looked at the others confused.
Bathroom,
Roach said as they walked out the back door.
I think it was the Wampa tacos.
He took a sip of the milk and said,
Barb, you're gonna want to see this.
Roach's face turned pitiful and he walked over to the booth of scientists who had been looking at them. A woman and a short man were on the right, and a tall man was on the left. Standing at the end, Roach said,
Excuse me, I'm lost. I can't find my parents. I was having my milkshake and the next thing I knew they were gone. Could you help me find them?
Weren't you with the woman and the green troll? The woman asked. Maybe he went to throw someone off a bridge, the tall one joked. The small one laughed. Roach chuckled with him and said,
Yeah, that's a good one.
And he threw the milk all over the short one, though much of it flew over him and landed on the woman behind him. Roach spat on the large one across from them and kicked the short one in the shin for good measure and dashed out the back. The angry patron stood and took chase. Roach flew out the door and into the back area and dashed for a gap in the wooden fence. The three patrons came out after. The woman was last, and the door slammed shut behind her. A gloved hand grabbed her by the shoulder. A shock of electricity coursed through her, knocking her unconscious. The short one turned to find the kid's female companion standing there wearing shock gloves. The green beast poked around the corner and fired a sunblast from a blaster pistol which knocked the short man unconscious. The tall one, still chasing the kid, turned at the sound of blaster fire and didn't see a puddle that the kid had jumped over. He slipped and hit his head on the cement, knocking him unconscious. Roach stopped and said to his unconscious form,
Still think my friend looks funny?
The door began to open again, and Elor slammed her body against it to keep anyone else from coming out. Yalta dragged the bodies around back of the restaurant. As he did, he muttered that he suddenly realized the problem in his plan. They probably didn't have time to take the clothes off.
Okay. Don't ask me how I know how to do this.
And he whipped the pants off the short man in a couple of swift strokes.
Why am I not surprised?
Yalta said, and they got to work. Elor peeked open the door just enough to see two people trying to get out.
There's nothing to see here. Everything is under control.
The two at the door stopped and turned to everyone behind them, saying, There's nothing to see here. Everything is under control. The hell it is! Barb shouted. I heard blaster fire! Sirens were now heard getting closer. They hadn't gotten the clothes off the tall one yet, but they would have to be satisfied with what they had. So Yalta and Roach grabbed what they had, and the three of them dashed away from the restaurant, crossing the street, making their way through backyards and alleys. Reggie hacked the police scanners and monitored their positions, sending them to Yalta so he could successfully make their way back to the skyport. There, they climbed into the skyhopper and flew away. Yalta took the controls, making a wide circle around the mesa while Roach and Elor changed into the clothes of the scientists. Though one of the scientists had been short, he was still taller than Roach, so his clothes hung loose over him. Elor's fit just right. They came back in toward the science center and landed in the skyport as though flying in from another part of the planet. The three of them got out, Yalta continuing to pretend to be their slave as he carried a pack for them and they approached the guard station. And Reggie came along with them this time. Security at the front appeared quite light. This was definitely not like the Imperial stations they were used to. There were two guards, and only one was watching them. Elor held up a hand and began to speak in her voice of control, but Roach grabbed her hand and held it down.
Greetings, fellow scientists. I'm Dr. Yali Dentra. I'm here as a guest scientist from the Freebird Institute of Higher Thought, and I've been invited to come collaborate on the Human Superiority Project for the Humanities. Please show me to the lab that I will be using.
The other guard had turned his attention to them now, and they were staring at Roach curiously. What's with the milk stain? One of them asked.
Oh, that.
Roach laughed, remembering the stain he had caused.
Yeah, My slave is so clumsy.
The guards continued to stare at him. Then the first one said, We're going to need to see some identification. Roach sighed and said,
Okay, do the hand thingy.
Aylor stepped forward and waved her hand.
You don't need to see his identification.
One of the guards responded, We don't need to see his identification. Aylor continued,
He is a distinguished guest.
He is a distinguished guest.
You will open the gate for us.
Open the gate for them.
We can go on in.
You can go on in. Welcome.
Ooh, Eleanor, ask for a tour.
Roach whispered.
And cake!
But Yalto kicked him and they went inside.
This is not the cake you were looking for.
Walking down the main central hall, they could see into many of the rooms. They were testing liquids, various types of blood, and poring over data in their computers. One large room that Aylor felt subconsciously drawn to had white crystals held in place, which were being monitored and prodded by a host of equipment which dangled down like spider legs. A light haze spilled from these crystals, which was quickly blown into a vent which seemed to lead to large vats. Aylor felt a strong presence within those vats.
You think that girl Briely worked here?
Roach asked a little too loud. Aylor shushed him, but as she did, Yalto noticed something in an adjoining room. One of the scientists sitting at a console reacted to Roach's words. At the sound of Briley's name, the man's head jolted up, and he turned to look at who had said the name. Spotting a large green man staring at him, he quickly got back to work. As they continued down the hall, they began to notice Imperial engineers and guards working alongside the Kassido ones. They kept silent until they reached the end of the hall. There, they entered a room where they were doing animal testing. Aylor looked with pity at the local animals that had been captured and put in far too small of cages, but she knew there was nothing she could do. The group found a corner of the room where they were far enough away from the others not to be heard. There, Yalto told the others about the man who noticed the name Briely. He made a plan for he and Aylor to go check this man out while Roach and Reggie went to the data room and downloaded whatever they could about what was being studied at the facility.
We're gonna need a way to communicate silently so no one hears us,
he mused while thinking about what they could do.
I got it covered,
Roach said, and he stared intensely at Aylor. After a few confusing moments, Aylor asked, What are you doing?
I'm sending a message to you through the Force.
That's not how the Force works,
she said, and she turned to Yalto.
How about we just tap the comms? Once means it's time to leave, twice means we need the other group's help.
Everyone else agreed, and they headed to their respective rooms.
Reggie, it is so cool we get to work together,
Roach said.
I have a feeling this is the start of a beautiful friendship.
While Reggie probed the various access ports, Roach looked carefully for the most important part of the terminals.
You think it might be one of these?
Reggie squawked and beeped in return, but it was not an answer. It was a warning. Roach quickly pulled out a tool and acted like he was about to fix something.
That's right, R3,
he said loud enough to be heard.
I do think this coupler has gotten loose again. We may need to replace it.
The guards passed by, and Roach realized they would return, so he whispered to Reggie,
Okay, you pick a port out of one of those terminals. I'll look busy in front of you.
Yalto showed the way to the room where he had seen the scientists with a keen interest in what they were doing. Aylor entered the room first, and they walked about it while she pretended to be interested in the work that was being done. Yalto watched the scientist out of the corner of his eye, and he could see that he was glancing at them. One hand seemed to hover near a drawer. There were a couple other scientists and an assistant in the room, though they were on the opposite side. Yalto looked curiously over the shoulder of one of them until he became too intimidated to stay. He took the assistant with him and left. The other remained, too dedicated to her work to be bothered. Since only one was left, Yalto tried a different tactic. He stood in front of the woman. The hand of the man who was their target slid into the drawer.
What are you reaching for?
Came a whispered voice from in front of him. On the opposite side of his desk was Aylor, leaning over toward him. The man pulled out his hands and showed them. Aylor studied his face, hoping to find answers. She could really use Valena's power of insight right now. But even without Force abilities, she could see fear. Fear and resignation. Like he was caught and was prepared to pay the consequences. This was not someone who was preparing to capture them. Quite the opposite.
You recognized the name Briely Creslat earlier,
Aylor said.
How do you know her?
She's part of the scientific community on Dioll, the scientist said. Many of us know each other.
There was something more,
Yalto whispered.
Your head jolted up at her name.
The man clamped his mouth shut with a determined gaze. He looked at the drawer now, clearly considering grabbing what was in there. Aelor went out on a limb and told them,
"We're not with Kassido or the Empire."
Yalto's breath held, petrified at how this man would answer. His first response was a sigh of relief, and he lowered his hands. "Is she in trouble?" he asked.
"Not that we're aware of,"
Aelor answered.
"Why?"
"The Empire began working closely with Kassido recently, and ever since then, we've all been under scrutiny. She has a history with them, and I believe they will soon be moving on her."
"Why would they be moving in on her?"
Yalto asked. The man sighed, considering. Then he decided to take a leap of faith, and he whispered, "She and I have been leading a resistance of slaves and others who have been oppressed under Kassido. If they have found out, I believe she is in terrible danger." If you enjoyed this video, please thumb us below and let your friends know. Also put in the comments anything you think the characters should have done differently. Click on the next video to continue watching the story, and you can find other stories written by the author in the description below. May the Force be with you, and happy gaming, everybody!